thank the Lord for His Holy Spirit. Amen.
Glory.
What I want to share very briefly is just I prepared something else. This morning I was just thinking and it was like my mind was blank. I was saying, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to speak on. There's so many things to talk about. But it seems like you're not really specifically telling me what to say and what to preach on. So I just thought of a scripture that I shared on Friday with a prayer at the prayer meeting. And so with that scripture, the Lord changed it. Turn with me in your Bibles to Zechariah. I believe that the Lord is speaking, because you know this verse, which has always been the theme of the servants of God. Zechariah chapter 4. Praise the Lord. And verse 6.
Amen.
Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6. To verse 9. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 to verse 9. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, This is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel thou shalt become a plain. He shall bring forth the headstone thereof, and with shoutings crying, Grace, grace unto it. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this house. His hands shall also finish it. Thou shalt know that the Lord of hosts hath sent me unto you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. A well-known scripture preached in all Pentecostal circles. I want to just take us and remind us again, because I know that the Lord is speaking to me to speak to us concerning this word. Now we all know this word, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit. God is speaking to Zerubbabel through Zechariah. Let me just give you a brief history about it so that we can understand it more clearly, especially for people like you and me. Israel was taken captivity, and then God sent back the first group to come and rebuild the temple that was destroyed. And when they were sent back, Zerubbabel was the man that God had given him the task to rebuild the temple. Ezra came on later and helped finish it. This is the man, Zerubbabel. And the first 2 years when he came back to Jerusalem, he made a mighty head start. Got everything going, but then after 2 years the work stopped. There was a lot of opposition coming from here, coming from there, coming from those around him. They wrote letters to the governors and they wrote letters to the Persian and Mede Empire that was in rulership at that time, telling them that these people are a rebellious people. These people will build their temple. Jerusalem is a rebellious city. And so they wrote letters to try to stop the work, and the work did stop. 2 years into it, they just laid the foundation. And 2 years, the work stopped. And it stopped for 17 years. 17 years, the work stopped, never move again. And all the others was rejoicing and said, there, that's the will. And then God raised up 2 prophets. And they came and spoke to Zerubbabel. One of them is Zechariah. He's the one who came and prophesied this word upon him. And the other is Haggai. So can we just turn to Haggai? Let me just share with you the words of Haggai. Just the book before that. A very powerful word. Verse 2, the timing is in the second year of Darius, in the 6th month. But here he's speaking in verse 2, Haggai chapter 1 verse 2. Thus speaketh the Lord of the host, saying, talking to Israel, these people say the time is not come, meaning the time is not right. It's not the season for it. These people say the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Praise the Lord. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. You looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why? Saith the Lord of hosts, because of mine house, there is waste, and you run every man unto his own house. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I'm going to stop here. Because Haggai rises up at this very season and time, and he prophesied, and he speaks upon Zerubbabel, and he speaks to the people concerning the work of the Lord. Now, you know this is the rebuilding of the temple. Well, let me show you one truth. Let me take it from Garden of Eden. Garden of Eden, there was only one entry, and that was from the east. It had the feature and pattern of worshiping God. His presence was there in the Garden of Eden. Then the flood came, there was no more Garden of Eden. God raised up Moses to build the tabernacle. Same design. Only one entrance is from the east. Okay, I'm using my right hand. It's from the east. Only one entrance, and the presence of God was in the tabernacle. And then later on you find King Solomon rebuilt the temple. Same design. Only one entrance from the east. All the elements that is in there is talking about Christ. His earthly ministry and his heavenly ministry. Then you come to the New Testament. You have the Garden of Eden, you have the tabernacle, and you have the temple. Jesus comes in the New Testament and he says these words, if this temple shall be pulled down, I will rebuild it in 3 days. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And the people got angry on him because they thought about this time when the rebuilding of the temple was done. It took them months. It took them hard labor. And they said, how can he say that he'll rebuild it in 3 days? Because they did not understand that Jesus was talking about his body. That when he will die, he will raise up in 3 days. Now we come to the next part, when the church is born, or the church is birthed, and you and I become the temple or the dwelling place of God. Praise the Lord. I link all that to bring us back to Haggai. Amen. Because the mission was, when God sent Zerubbabel, was to rebuild the temple. 2 years, and then they stopped. And for 17 years, no work was done. 17 years you can do so. 17 years you can accept what is happening around you. Oh, I think so. Maybe it's not God's will to rebuild this temple. That's why Haggai says, you say this is not the season. He tells them, you say this is not the time. But God is saying, this is the time. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise the Lord. When we study this life of Zerubbabel, when he started the ministry, when he came back, he was called back to Jerusalem to rebuild the temple. He had a bullet start. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Everything, he was on fire. He was zealous. He got everything going. He got everything working out. Just like you and I, many times when we start our walk with Christ, we start bullet stuff. We start already on fire. We can walk. We don't need to wait for the transport. We can go by horse, or we can go by any kind of transport. Praise the Lord. But we need to get to the place of worship. Hallelujah. And many of us start that way. We start bullet stuff. We start all on fire for God. And then something's creeping into our life. Something start to some discouragement come. Some discouragement and some diversion come, and we drift from what God have us to do. And 17 years, this temple was left idle. You know, when I hear that or when I see that in scripture, it really touched me. Because I want to tell you something. Some of us sitting here still have unaccomplished tasks left to be done. I speak because I know I have some unaccomplished things. Some work that God called me to do. Some vision that God called me to accomplish. Some area that God had called me into to do it. And as I look into my life, I realize something. I haven't finished it yet. So God brought these two prophets. And they prophesy upon Zerubbabel. And they spoke to the people. And not only did they speak, they got up and did the work. And he spoke to them through Haggai. He says, the reason why you were where you are now, you work so hard and you earn so little, you get so little. And even when you get a lot, your pocket is like full of holes. Everything just like just coming and going. You don't know where it's going and where. What's happening? He says, because you live in good houses, but you leave my house unattended to or unfinished. Now, I'm not talking about a building. Listen carefully. When I talk temple, I talk people. Praise the Lord. When we talk church, we talk people. Praise the Lord. And I want to tell us, sometimes God gives us a dream and we got a good start. But somewhere yesterday, that dream kind of just stalled, hanging, and neutral, and not able to accomplish. And that's where I'm coming today. I'm coming today. The season is now. Whatever God has called you for in the past, He is able to complete. The Word of God says, He that started a good work in you is able to finish it. Paul writes one of his letters and says, faithful is he that has called you, faithful he will perform it. Praise the Lord. I don't know what you're going through, but as I hear this text, as I go through this text, I know I have some unfinished business to attend to. Praise the Lord. Some things God told me to do some years ago. I start with a head start, and then somewhere I just drip. And I realize today as I go through this scripture, it not only applies to me, but it also applies to you, the church. That there are some things God call us for. And we started well. And we started good. But somewhere down the road, discouragement come in. And we lose out. Well, the good news is today. Hallelujah. Yeah. Zechariah writes and tells Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, say the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And he tells Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel, this very mountain that kept you from finishing the task. This very mountain that kept you from finishing the call. This mountain shall be leveled to the ground. God has given you. This message I'm preaching today is prophetic. Hallelujah. It's not only something that we can learn for discipleship, but I'm speaking prophetically upon the church. Whatever has stopped in the past, whatever has kind of just stalled and just become neutral. Well, I want to tell you today, it's not my might, it's not my power, but it is by my spirit, say the Lord. This big mountain that held you back yesterday, this thing that has been discouraging you, today is the day of revival. Hallelujah. This mountain shall be leveled. And that's God's prophetic word to the church. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I don't know everything about you, but God knows. And I'm thankful that Jesus came and he had to go back to heaven. Amen? He came and he said, I have to go back so that he, the Comforter, he, the Holy Spirit, will come. And I'm thankful to that. Because if Jesus didn't go back, then he cannot be everywhere all the time. He will be limited because of his human form, his bodily form. But I thank God that he went back to heaven. So that the Holy Spirit can be present. Glory. That Jesus can be present here. Yeah. He can be present the road, just the church down the road. In the church on the other side. He can be everywhere, all the time, every time. For the glory of his wonderful name of Jesus. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Give a big hand clap to Jesus. Turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor. This mountain. shall be removed. Help your other neighbor and said, you know that mountain that always keep you back? Tell your other neighbor, you know that mountain? You know this mountain. Tell your neighbor, that mountain shall be leveled. Hallelujah. It's a reality for me this morning. As I sit down and I look back, I've got plenty of unfinished work to do. I was just telling Pastor Eggie yesterday, early this morning, I said, Pastor Eggie, that's why I have to keep on going back to Tuma. Because there's something that God called me to do, I haven't finished. And unless I finish it, then I can come. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I know deep down in our hearts you want me to be here since last 5 years. But then I shared with her my prayer line. See, this is my prayer line. I said, God, all these years I've been in Rutuma. By your Holy Spirit, you can accomplish 8 years of work in just 1 week. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. He can do our laboring for years. He can just do it in just an instant. 6 days he created the heavens and the earth. When he spoke, it came to pass. Many of us see all the wonderful features of the stars and all the galaxies and all kind of ones we can see and ones we cannot see in the human eye. But the Bible said in day four of creation, God called them by name. And as he called them out, all the stars just start to appear. He called them by name, each and every one. And they appeared in the heavens. And he fulfilled. So nothing is impossible with God. And that has been my prayer. And Lord, what I have accomplished in all these years, please can you do it again in just a short time, quicken it by your Spirit before you come back. Hallelujah. Amen. Give a big hand clap to Jesus. Some of your dreams that you dreamed yesterday seem so impossible to achieve. I want to tell you something. With this kind of scripture, God can do anything.
Hallelujah.
Your dream, 10 years passed by, 20 years passed by, you still haven't able to step into the fullness of what God called you. I want to tell you today, the Holy Spirit is present to quicken everything, to quicken the work of the Lord, to quicken your spirit, to quicken His task, so that He can accomplish it in just a moment. He can make it happen. Praise the Lord. You've never seen a wounded plant today and eat tomorrow. Praise the Lord. You never seen that kind of growth. I tell you, nothing impossible with God. Because when He created, when He called out the plants and they came out, all of a sudden they start sprouting and they start bearing fruit at the same time. Then when Adam came in day six, it was all bearing fruit. You with me? When God created him, day six, when he came and he appeared, all the fruits, the tree were bearing fruits. God spoke it. Seed bearing. He said, all the seed bearing plant, he spoke and it came to pass. And it grew. Hallelujah. And when it grew, it bare fruit in just a short time. God can do anything. Hallelujah. You may have some difficulty in finance. God have no problem with finance. Praise the Lord. You may have difficulty with your own self. Low self-esteem or discouragement all the time. God, the Holy Spirit, is able to take them and turn it around for His glory. Amen. 17 years. Zerubbabel, sit down and look at the foundation. And I want to tell you something. I'm thankful to God. Many of you sitting down here, almost all of you sitting down, the foundation has been laid already in your life. Amen. Praise the Lord. 17 years, only the foundation built. He lost hope. He don't know how it's going to happen. According to the letter that was given him from the government, he's not allowed to rebuild. Because Jerusalem is a rebellious city. But these two men came and stand beside him.
Hallelujah.
They started to prophesy over his life. You know, in the time you're down and out, God will send a prophet. Praise the Lord. He will send an encourager. He will send someone to rebuild you, to help you, so that you and I can stand in this day and time for the glory of His name. I was reminded of Moses. The battle was going on in the valley with the Amalekites. And Joshua was the general in the army, and they were fighting and they were warring. And as long as Moses' hands was lifted up, Israel was winning. But then his hands started to drop. He was getting tired. And as he was getting tired, these other two men came and stand beside him. Aaron and Hur. And they came and they helped hold his hand together so that the victory is won for Israel.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Nothing impossible. And there are times God sends somebody along your way. God sends someone to stand beside you. God sends someone to pray over you. God sends someone to just to provide a covering over your life in prayer and fasting. And it is this kind of people, Haggai and also Zechariah, who stood beside Zerubbabel. And they said, it is possible with God. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, say the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You can't do it any other way. Can't do it any other way. Can I just close with what Haggai said? Praise the Lord. Turn with me to Haggai chapter 1. Verse 2. This way I'm going to close. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, these people say the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. The people are saying it's not the time. The people are saying it's not the season. I want to tell you, with God, it's the season.
Amen.
Amen. Jesus was walking with his disciples. And he said, lift up your eyes to the harvest. And as they lift up their eyes to the harvest, Jesus said, man said that it will be 3 or 4 months' time, then harvest. But I say, it is ripe and ready for the harvest. Praise the Lord. Your natural eyes might deceive you. What you see and put in your mind and in your heart and in your soul and your emotion may be different from what God is saying. The disciples said, oh yeah, the harvest is not ready. But Jesus said, but I say, look to the fields. It is white and ready for harvest. Amen. Praise the Lord. The season is right. Last Sunday I talked to us on season. The season is here. And when the season is here, just like in Rutu, when it's coming to the season, all the pineapple, they start to... And then you know, oh, Christmas is here. If someone was in a coma for a long time and you woke up and you look outside and you saw the pineapple, you know Christmas is arriving. Because the season dictates the fruit. Praise the Lord. Then I talked to us last week about the difference in sweetness of fruit. The pineapple that is in the sun, that's the one that's going to be sweet. But the one that's in the shade, it looks very sweet, but it's very sour. That's why you have to get closer to the Son of God. Hallelujah. Amen. All the difficulties of life, that's what make you sweet. All the hurt and all the pain, they bring out in you the sweetness. Then they never say, sweet or bitter? Then you have a neighbor and say, get out of the shadow. Get out of the shadow. You're going to have to stand in the sun for a while. I never shared this thing with you. But in Rutuma, if you break the pineapple and you see that it's not sweet, you know what they do? They won't eat it immediately. They'll break it and put it on the roof or somewhere in the sun. Need some more sun. Hallelujah. The more sun, the more sweet. Praise the Lord. Even though you grow in the shade, we'll have to bring you out from the shade and put you in the sun. Give a big hand clap to Jesus. Last Sunday I talked to us about the season. Now it's important to walk in the atmosphere of revival. Amen? And you find that in Acts chapter 2, they were in the upper room with one accord, one heart, one faith, one spirit. You have to be at the right place. Because that builds up the atmosphere for revival. Amen? If you're in the wrong place, then you'll be like all the others. They were in the temple, but the revival happened in the upper room. Praise the Lord. You with me? You can be in the temple. You can be in the church, but the revival happens in the upper room. Give a big hand clap to Jesus. The atmosphere is very important for your life and my life. And when I thought about it, I said, man, no wonder. When God sent the fire from heaven, when He breathed upon the 120, the sound of a mighty rushing wind, he blew up, and all of a sudden, tongues of fire came. He never sent one fire where everybody can fit in. He sent specifically, specially designed for you, called for, by God for your calling. He put each and every one a tongue of fire. So God have a specific calling for you. God have a plan for you. Praise the Lord. And if that dream has been lost, well, today, the season is now. Give another. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. Don't try to do anything in your own ability. It has to be Holy Spirit from the beginning and Holy Spirit all the way to the end. Now I like what the finishing in Zechariah. This is what it said. The same hand that started the work in rebuild is the same hand that's going to finish, to put the last stone to finish the temple. Let me say it again. It's calling upon Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, the same hand that started and laid the foundation in the beginning is the same hand that will finish. You see, when God called you for something, He not only just to call you halfway, okay, Sarota, it's time for you to go. No. You start a good work, and He'll finish it. The dream that God gave you and the calling, don't worry. He going to finish it through you. You put your hand and lay the first stone, well, praise the Lord. You're going to lay the last stone also, and that is by faith. Amen. Praise the Lord. Give a big hand clap to Jesus. Sometimes we start and then after that we think, oh, maybe God called me to go and do this and somebody else is going to finish it. Listen, God called you to do it, He's going to finish it. Amen. God called you to be a missionary, He's going to train you, not for you to give up in the training and then stop short and say, okay, that's it. No, if He called you to go to mission, He's going to train you, He's going to build you, He's going to equip you, He's going to shape you, He's going to mold you, He's going to melt you, He's going to rebuild you. And after He's done all that, He doesn't stop there and say, okay, now it's finished. For you and I sometimes, oh Lord, this is it, finish for me. No. The work is not over. Hallelujah. And then He takes you and then He puts you right where He has trained you for. Amen. That's what I'm talking about vision. But when I talk about dream, when God give you a calling, God give you a dream, God give you a vision, God give you a purpose. Listen, your purpose is right from the beginning to the very end. He started with you, He landed with you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. God bless you. Amen. God strengthen you. Amen. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Be He strong.
Amen.
Don't give up so easily. Don't give up. The pineapple will never be sweet until it survives that whole day in, day out with all that sun. When the time is ready, when you break it, before you even cut it, the juice is already coming. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God already prepared you. Praise the Lord. Some of you sit here. You shouldn't be actually sitting and just hanging around in the church. You should be pastoring. Some of you call here to pastor.
Hallelujah.
Some of the district, you want to move on, but you're still waiting. Wait for God's time. I always have a problem when you say, wait for God's time. This is God's time.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God can move the heavens and the earth for you. In your physical eyes, no. It's not God's time. But in God's spiritual eyes, it's your time. Some of you are called to go and preach down the street here. Some of us sitting down here, God has called you for administration. Please get up and come and see Pastor again. Give you administration gifts. Praise the Lord. God has specifically called you and I for a purpose. So this is the season that we rise up to. And I'll finish with this word. You and I have to multiply. Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue. The work of evangelism is not for the pastor. It's for you and I to multiply. Go and witness for friend. You know your testimony? Your friend is waiting for their testimony. What God did to you last month, someone is waiting for you to tell them that God is able. In school, or in work, or whatever, God has called you to be fruitful. It's good to stay here and worship the Lord and allow to see the manifest glory of God. It's good. Just like James, John, and Peter was in the Mount of Transfiguration. They loved that place. Because when they saw Jesus and Elijah, and they saw Moses, their heart full of joy. They told Jesus, It's a big one shed here, and we just hang around here. Jesus said, no, no. This is not the place to hang around. You have to go down the valley. The work is at the valley. Praise the Lord. Yeah. So it's good to come on Sunday and praise the Lord and worship and get touched by God. But after this, all of us have to go down to the valley. Praise the Lord. We have to come down our high horse and go down and tell people that Jesus is the answer. I have to do it as a pastor. You have to do it as a believer. You can tell your neighbor, never mind me. Gossip you behind your back. It's okay. Praise the Lord. You must tell somebody. You have a friend, ring him or ring her. Tell her Jesus Christ is the answer. Invite them to church. Invite them to the cell group. Praise the Lord. God study, he'll finish it. He'll be using it. Let's all stand together as we come to close.